Okay. I see a bump at 4. That 4 is much higher than where it should have been.
Yeah.
I see another bump at 9 where it is like maybe 10% instead of 5.
Yeah.
What do you think it means?
It means the manager and the employees have been makhan eating a lot.
Right. Do you think that a 5th standard kid, well, 7th standard kid, would be able to detect election fraud if just given the number of votes in all the different ballot boxes? What do you think, Shrikant?
No, ma. What? How? Wait, what?
Yeah. So that is today's video. It's about a concept called Benford's law. Let me explain with an example. Okay. A different example.
Okay.
Now imagine there is an office in which employees are allowed to spend up to 5,000 on their own with just their manager's approval.
Like most offices, there is always some petty cash.
And then there's a next level for 10,000. There is, manager's approval is needed.
Correct.
Anything more than that goes through a much more elaborate process.
Correct. Correct.
Okay. Now, the CFO of the company believes that there are a lot of fraudulent expenses going on in the company. Right? How would they detect that? Now, the first thing you would imagine is that you have to go through all the receipts and then you have to see which one seems fake and, just basically bring in Sherlock Holmes, right?
Yeah. I mean, how do you figure out which of them is fake otherwise?
So, Benford's law is a very interesting statistical law, which probably you haven't heard of, but it's fun. Okay.
Okay.
So, let me ask this. If I just took all the expense receipts and all the payments that were made out, and let's say I end up with 12,000 different amounts. Okay. Now, here is a very simple thing I'm going to do. Okay. I am going to take the first digit out of every amount.
Okay.
First digit, not the last digit. First digit. So, if it is a reimbursement of 462, I will take 4. If it's a reimbursement of 1,300, I will take 1. First digit.
Okay.
And then I just count them. Count all the digits. How many 1s, how many 2s, what percentage were 1s, what percentage were 2s, what percentages were 9s. I plot them. What do you think the distribution will be like?
Has to be random. Like, anybody can reimburse any amount between 1 and whatever number.
Right. So, you expect like it would be,
an equal number of 1s, equal number of 2s.
10-11% 1s, 10-11% 2s and so on, right?
Yeah.
Actually, that's not what happens, right? In a lot of real world cases, the distribution is like a skewed distribution, okay? 1/3 of the numbers will usually be starting with 1. About, a little less than 1/5 of the numbers will be starting with 2 and so on. And it falls down all the way so that the 8s and the 9s are about like 5% and 4%.
And okay. Why would that be? How does that make sense?
So, the thing to realize is that when, let's say, that I took a large number of numbers from 1 to 200. You realize that half of them will start with 1.
Oh, yeah.
Right? Or if it was from 1 to 300, a lot of them will start with 1, some with 2. So, because it is open-ended, whenever you cross to the next number of digits, for a long time, you see only 1s.
Yeah.
Right? So, in fact, let's not get too much into the details of why it happens. Even mathematicians get a little worried.
No, but this makes sense because when you cross a certain order of 10, the next so many numbers are going to start with 1, and that is where you're going to be mandraving around. Plus, also, I think a lot of times what we do is, if it's a higher number, like say 850 or 900, we round it off to the nearest multiple of 10.
Right. So, even if you do something like, take the first digit of the populations of all the countries and territories in the world, right? Now, it's not a very large number, 236 only, okay? So, you expect when the numbers are not large, it won't follow laws very easily.
Yeah.
But even then, you notice that it's a very similar curve.
Okay? Very interesting.
Right? So, now coming back to our example, I want to look at fraud.
Huh.
Okay.
The office fraud.
The office fraud. I just take all the amounts that were paid out and I look at their first digits and I do this analysis, very easy to do in Excel, and then I plot it, right? And if I notice that there is, it instead of it being a very simple curve with a high at 1 at around 1/3 and going all the way down to 9 at around 5%, okay? I see a bump at 4. That 4 is much higher than where it should have been.
Yeah.
And I see another bump at 9 where it is like maybe 10% instead of 5.
Yeah.
What do you think it means?
It means the manager and the employees have been makhan eating a lot.
Right. Basically, what it means is that instead of the expenses being random, right, there is extra expenses being squeezed into the below 5,000. So, that's why there is a bump at 4. And there is some being squeezed into the below 10,000. So, there is a bump at 9. Right?
Listen, the manager can only approve a maximum expense of 5,000 or rather under 5,000. So, a lot of 4,999 expenses are going to come into the list.
Yeah. Again, you know, this might not be fraud. But
yeah,
at the very least, you know that there is some distortion happening.
In the data.
Yeah. But if you took all the number of votes in all the ballot boxes individually in an election and then you plotted them, you better see a Benford's law curve like this.
Ooh.
If you see a bump at inappropriate places, or if you see a shape that is different, that means there is high chance that there was something funny going on in this election.
Yeah.
In fact, in Iran, in the 2009 election, there were widespread allegations that Ahmadinejad won the election.
Terribly sorry to any Iranians who might be watching this video. We try to make sure that we get the pronunciations right, but just are a little weak with the language. So, again, apologies. I think it's
Ahmadinejad.
Extremely sorry, don't mean to laugh. The laughter is about us not being able to do it rather than the name itself.
Yeah.
Ahmadinejad. There you go.
So, there were widespread allegations of fraud, and statisticians have gone and looked at the numbers and found that Benford's law was violated. In fact, you can go one step further. If you look at the votes received by his opponent, there is a nice Benford's law curve. But if you look at the votes for Ahmadinejad, then you see the Benford's law curve being violated.
Now, the entire question about the 7th standard student and election fraud makes sense. Because even a 7th standard student can count those numbers and plot that on a graph.
So, in fact, one of the interesting things there is that usually, if the numbers haven't come naturally. If they come naturally, then they follow the Benford's law curve. If they didn't come naturally, if somebody sat and typed in, just came up with a bunch of numbers, then usually what you find is that the curve is like low on the sides and high in the middle, because humans don't want to do anything extreme. And you will see 4, 5, 6 high and the others down, right? So there are certain curves where you know this was manually generated, this was generated by a computer using a uniform distribution, that would be like a flat curve and so on.
Like in life, mathematics is also dictated by a lot of curves. I said that. I did. All right. So, this basically tells me that now that I know Benford's law, I can fool it. All I have to do is make sure that everything in it that I'm trying to manipulate follows the Benford's law curve.
Well, maybe, right?
It's, maybe.
Well, one thing to keep in mind is that Benford's law, even if you make sure that the first digits follow the curve, there is a different Benford's law curve for the second digits. And if you didn't look at that, you will still get caught, and third digit and so on, right? That is one thing to keep in mind.
Okay.
The other thing to keep in mind is that criminals are not very smart, actually, right? They get caught. In fact, some of the greatest scientists in the world have been caught by simple statistical checks like this. There is a book called Predictably Irrational by a scientist whose name I won't take, but one of his papers, somebody analyzed the numbers in there and found that the distribution was wrong, and that is pretty clear that the paper was fake, right? The numbers in the paper were made up, right? So this is a world famous scientist. The book Predictably Irrational is there in my house, and I'm sure Shrikant has also heard of it.
I have heard of the book, and I'm sure you guys are going to search for the book. So go ahead, check it out. But I'm still trying to figure out whether Navin complimented me or insulted me when he said that criminals are not smart. Yeah. When I actually asked him about trying to be a criminal. But anyway, so there are multiple Benford's law that I will have to take into account. So it kind of makes sense to not attempt any fraud in that sense. But can I apply Benford's law in my daily life? Is there anything?
Well, I mean, you know, if you are a fraud detector or an auditor of accounts, then of course you should be applying it in your daily life. In fact,
I have not.
Handbooks that are given out to IT auditors, for example. In fact, they have a nice explanation of Benford's law and how to apply it.
Okay.
Similarly, ISACA is a association for cybersecurity.
Okay.
And they also explain nicely how to apply Benford's law to keep your company secure. But, you know, maybe not something you can apply in daily life, right? You don't want to check your son's numbers like this. But, you know, what I want to say is that not everything needs to be applicable in real life, right? I think you should be curious about interesting things just generally, even if it doesn't apply in real life. You never know when it will start applying.
That is true, especially if you're called in to verify the results of an election and declare it a fraud or not.
Right.
On that day, you will rue not knowing Benford's law.
Exactly.
If you didn't reach this point in the video. But since you reached this point in the video, you now know Benford's law. So congratulations. And if you've spotted examples of Benford's law, do tell us about it in the comments. My name is Shrikant. This is Navin. This is FutureIQ.
Thank you.
Thank you.